this
situation.
ask you one thing. Which if you tell me, I likewise will tell you my own authority and to be saved.
Remind people that, guys, this is the temple of the Lord, don't make it into a market. So also during that time when Jesus was in the temple of Jerusalem, he also met a blind and a lame, and again Jesus come to heal them. So Jesus performed a lot of miracles, and at the same time he also cleansed the temple of Jerusalem. And while he was doing that, there's this chief priests and elders who were observing, and they were like, who is this man who suddenly come to, it's my area, and then you kind of just make a lot of perform a lot of works, clear the marketplace, under whose authority are you? So that's why the title of the video earlier was Jesus' authority was being questioned by these chief priests and elders. And so what happened is that Jesus was trying to challenge them. What authority did John the Baptist have when he also came to the world and healed, baptized people in the Lord's name? And basically, we say, if I say it's from heaven, and then we'll be challenged back, then why don't you believe me that it's from heaven? But if we say it's from off earth, then you will be scared with what the crowds will say because of their pride. So that's why they say, I don't know anything, and want to push it back the question to Jesus. So Jesus, while he is trying, he realized that it's very hard to tell directly to the chief priest. That's why he used this parable as an analogy. And in this parable with the two sons, actually Jesus was trying to bring comparison. The first son is actually the one that say, I don't want to do, but eventually do. So he's trying to create association with the tax collectors and prostitutes, who in people's mind, they are the sinners. They are they didn't follow the religion, the regulations, and they never follow the Lord's commandment. They mix things. However, they repent, and when they come to Jesus, they change their life. So that's actually the hidden message that God wants to say, that this is actually the first son, and then the second son is the one that, I will do God's will, but eventually never do. And actually, Jesus want to hint that chief priest is actually you. And it's also quite funny, in the end, these chief priests and elders were actually tricked into the question. And when they were asked which of the two did the father's will, and they actually answered the first, which is actually pointing to the tax collectors and prostitutes. And at the end, we can see of how Jesus reaffirmed again that I say to you, tax collectors and prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God before you. And when John came to you in a very righteous way, you don't want to believe. But tax collectors and prostitutes, as they did turn into believing in God. For these chief priests, so even when you saw, you did not make a change of mind and believe him. So that's actually the whole story and the context of why Jesus used this parable. And I think it's really interesting of, sometimes the chief priests and elders, they have their pride, and therefore always try to protect themselves and think that they are always right. But actually, even though they try to appear religious, they actually never show that love and mercy through Christians to really share the love of God and believe in Him. While on the other hand, tax collectors who might have made mistakes before, but they repented. So actually, from these two group of people, the two different sons, actually none of them are good in a way. It's actually a story of two bad sons. And in today, when I went for mass, the father was even emphasized that, actually the best is the third son, which is not here. And the third son is actually Jesus, the one that say yes to the Lord and his will, obey until the end. So that is actually the one that we need to follow in our lives instead of either of these two. But nevertheless, God always opened up his hands for either of these two sons who wants to turn back. And even though you might have made mistakes, but along the way, if you repented and go back to him, you will also be safe. Yeah. And for me, particularly, personally, when I listened to these words, it really struck my heart, especially for the second son. I think when I hear about the second son, I feel like, oops, that's me, many times. And I think, like just an example, you know, at work, when times got busy, a lot of times when my boss tell me to do something, I will just, I'll do it, need it by then, okay, I'll do it, and give to you. But after some time, I sometimes forget about what she asked and then miss the deadline. Or there are times when I also like procrastinate and do other things and makes me actually forget and broke my promises to my boss. And similarly, like because I work as in marketing and I work with a lot of agencies, so creative agency who will help me to do my work in the design part. And many times I actually was the one to tell them, guys, please send me by this date, I will give you feedback by this time, and then you must return and deliver everything to me by this date. But a lot of times, actually, they deliver as per what they have committed because we pay them, right? But then, many times for me, I always kind of miss out the giving the feedback part and ended up, I'm actually causing the delay, but because my challenge is also because I am a client and I pay them. So sometimes I realize I have the pride of me that I actually almost don't really say sorry to them, but in the end, like pretend that like nothing happened and hey, please deliver by this time. And I think that's really an easy tendency for me to do, where you know it's always very easy to say, but it's indeed sometimes very hard to do. And similarly, even in my relationship with God, a lot of times, you know, like, and it's still a struggle even up to now, even as I give you the teaching here, you know, there are a lot of promises that sometimes I make to God, especially after Life in the Spirit Camp, LIC, you know, like in that, yes, God is great, and then like, yeah, I will do this, I will serve the Lord, I will care for others, I will love people, I will forgive, but then, you know, like halfway, what happened? Yeah, so tired. And many times I broke promises to God, and even as simple as like wanting to commit to abstain from it on Friday, last Friday, what happened is because we had like meeting, and then my colleague said, okay, I will pack the meal for everyone in the meeting. And at that time, actually, I have the choice to like tell them, please choose the one without me. But I think I was like, please help me buy. And then they came with chicken bulgogi. And like, oh, it looks so nice. Okay, well, I have my today. Okay, I'll abstain tomorrow instead. And then, yeah, in the end, I failed to abstain. So that's where, again, like as I reflected on these words, it kind of really remind me again. And to be honest, I will still see that it's something not easy. I may fail again and again, but as we remember how God welcomes the tax collectors and prostitutes, it's always an invitation for us, you know, like no matter how far you have turned away, God is inviting you to turn back to Him and answer His calling to go back to His presence and His love. And as I reflect deeper, I also realized that there were moments when I was also like the first son, where we started with the one to do rejecting God, but at the end, really bearing the fruit after, really fulfilling, answering to His call. So at that time, it was after I graduated from NTU, and at that time, actually the closest kind of community that I know was Emmaus, because I know some of the seniors who a lot of them come from NTU. And at that time, actually, after graduation, I was telling myself, like, when I came to the Emmaus prayer meeting at that time, I don't really feel comfortable with those people who were there. I actually even thought that, okay, it's so weird, don't want to be with you. And there are times when I just feel awkward and I don't feel that belonging yet in the community. So what happened is that, like, as the seniors were trying to invite me and come join in our ministry, because they know that I serve in NTU CPG, and come and serve, be a teaching ministry or worship leader. But I was actually quite reluctant, and I told them, okay, like, I give a try, I give one teaching. And then after the teaching, I actually feel like, I don't feel very successful, I feel a bit lost on how to deliver it. And then I told the senior, okay, I think I don't want to serve now. and basically, I could kind of like leave the group and just enjoy being a member at that time. And what happened also is that I was very thankful that I was sent to Indonesia, so maybe it's like an escape. I don't need to serve. I want to take a break, actually, just to rest, you know, after 4 years of school and ministry. He's so tired now. So a while, give me a break, maybe 1 year, lah, then I will think about it again.
I think both studies are so hard.
Yeah, so studies, I think, you know, after exam, I think I had a brain dead, and then I don't want to do anything, too tired, and just want to relax. So yeah, I was kind of like lucky that I was sent to Indonesia for 7 months assignment. And actually, along the way, because I was alone, and Toby was still in Singapore, so, you know, long distance, so lonely, little friends in Indonesia. And then I started to kind of like crave or like long for a community, and that's where I started to Google for a nearby charismatic group. And I found one, it's like, I think, a cell group by the Holy Trinity community in Indonesia, in the church nearby. So I just can I try and go, and apparently after like going there, I was quite new, no one knows me, but actually they were so friendly and so welcoming that I was really touched by their love, even for me, who at that time is like strangers to them. And it kind of struck me of how maybe I feel that they might have felt awkward also, just like how I felt awkward when I joined Emmaus at the beginning. But they still don't give up to serve. They are even very active to, you know, approach me and ask how I am, ask how am I settling down in Jakarta after living in Singapore for so long. And actually, from that moment, it started to open my heart that, you know, like, these people so generously serve me through this community. And why am I being so selfish when I don't feel comfortable, then I just want to run away. So since then, like, as I come back to Singapore, that's where I started to, like, okay, I was still feeling a bit awkward, actually. I still felt not comfortable with some of the people in the Emmaus at the time. But I was really feeling that God really wanted me to serve here. and he really like kind of every time I think of going to other community, like it will be not peaceful and there's always like but I want to go out. Yeah, and I was actually even very tempted to like, you know, I like to dance and I always tell God, I want to join dance ministry outside. But then like somehow God is still like, he never say no, but he will still kind of encourage me to join INEOS. And furthermore, I think when Toby, also some of my friends served in INEOS, then it made me feel like, okay, I'll just do it now, just serve in INEOS first. And that's where like I started to serve more and more. And from there, actually, I realized of how throughout the journey, it is still difficult, even until now, still many challenges that I face. But there's a joy within that God is really, it's like a father happy looking at the daughter doing what he has asked to do. You know, like, and I always remember the time when, you know, someone was telling me that, you know, for a small daughter, the father asked the daughter to draw. See, the drawing is very ugly, but then the father is like, done daughter, you know, like, no matter how ugly it is, I love you, and I am very proud that you take the courage to draw. And it's kind of the same feeling that I had in my heart, and the journey is still tough, but slowly I do see fruits coming up to it.
What was the visual challenge for one?
Huh?
Easter vigil challenge.
Yes, Easter vigil. So yeah, actually that one, when you put up the challenge, I felt really challenged. But as I really forced myself and okay, sit and think how the experience has been, it really kind of like, oh, actually the God is really blessing us abundantly. Even through a simple experience of going for Eastern Vigil Mass with some of them. So that's where, like, you know, like, as we, even though we might be the second son in certain parts of our life, yet God is always calling us to back to Him. And also when we are being the first son, that is where God has abundant joy waiting for us as we repent and go back to Him and follow answering His calling in our life. Yeah. So as we proceed later with the sharing, I think one thing that I really want to remember is, you know, like, God, no matter you are son one or son two, remember that we need to strive for Son 3, the third son, which is Jesus, to never give up in our journey, to always, I think one of the part is also on finding out His will and to stay connected to Him, that enabled me also to know that God is calling me in this direction, and yes, to do and to obey. It's not easy, but let's ask for the grace of God to help us. And I think one quote from Pope Francis also is that, you know, holiness doesn't come instantly, you know, in one occasion you make mistake, you repent and done. But it's actually through a series of, you know, you make mistakes, repent, you make mistakes again, and you learn. And actually in the process, we grow closer and closer, step by step, towards holiness. So let's all do that, and we ask God for the grace to help us. Amen. Okay. After this, we'll have a sharing section. We'll divide into groups of